Now let's talk about what happens to a charge in a material. Here's an example of a charge that's in a material that can be polarized. That's typical of things like water, where the molecule itself can have a positive charge on one end and a negative charge on the other. The little charge that's here in the middle, as you see, is going to polarize this material. All the negative portions of the molecule are going to tend to point to my little positive charge, and the positive parts of the molecules are going to tend to move away. This changes the net force that you find on this charge, and since it's the net force that causes the electric field, that means it changes the electric field as well. The electric field in this case is my charge Q divided by 4 pi epsilon, not epsilon naught, and the distance that I go away from the charge squared in the direction that I choose to go. So if I want to know the electric field right here, for instance, let's find the electric field at that point, I would take my little positive charge Q, put that on the top, 4 pi epsilon, we'll talk about what epsilon is in a minute, this distance r, and I would square it, and then I would want to know the direction from my charge right here. So the electric field in this case is moving out away from that charge, and here's my unit vector in the r direction. Now let's go talk about what that epsilon value is. Epsilon is made up of two parts. Epsilon is the permittivity of my material, and that's like kind of saying how polarizable is it? How much can I polarize it? It's going to be given by this constant, which is a relative permittivity. So that's what's written right here in your table. Relative permittivity times epsilon naught, which was the permittivity of free space. This is a table from Appendix B in your textbook, and it shows the relative permittivity of several common materials. Right here, for instance, is vacuum. Vacuum is similar to air. See, there's air. And you can see that the permittivity of air or vacuum is going to be virtually the same as the permittivity of free space. Styrofoam is one of the materials that we often use in developing test fixtures to hold electromagnetic antennas or other devices, and that's because its relative permittivity is very similar to that of air. Teflon and other plastics, you can see, are going to be right here with values on the order of 2, maybe up to 4. So plastics typically have values of 2 to 4. Plexiglass, that's another plastic, has a value of 3.4. Glass has values of 4 to 10. Quartzes, 3.8 to 5. And then you'll find several ceramics and similar values here going from about 3 to 6. Soil, when it's dry, has ranges of 2.5 to 3, although when it's wet, it can be much higher. So another very important value right here is water. Pure water has an epsilon R of 80, and seawater ranges from 72 to about 80. Distilled water is about 80. So when you think of water materials, anything that has water, it's going to have values on the order of 80. So let's put some rough ideas here. If you're going to have something that's a really good, something that's very similar to air, it might have values like 1.03. If it's going to be a plastic or something on that order, it's going to be ranging from 2 to 4. Glasses, 4 to 10. And water, around 80. Another important set of factors that you'll find in your second table is the conductivity, and that's telling how well materials are able to conduct electrical signals. I just want to give you some rough ideas here and just make you aware that this table exists in the back of your book, although we're not going to discuss conductivity overly much at this point. Just realize if something is a good conductor, it probably has values like 10 to the 7th, and if it's a good insulator, it's probably things like 10 to the minus 2 and below.